that's going to be a wonderful day when we receive our crown of righteousness. Hallelujah. Let's sing together.
You came, you're coming again. Yes, he is, but this time as a lion.
Every voice to sing.
Your kingdom come, your will be done. We feel you drawing near.
Yes, we do.
And to love you, God, and lift you high until we see you here. Oh, your will be done on this earth. Have your will through the race we run.
Hey, good morning, NewSpring. How are you feeling today? Hey, didn't our worship team do a great job? Yeah. Hey, I'm so excited to be a part of this series. We've been talking about the fact that Jesus is coming back, and that is the theme of Clash 5. And, when I was getting ready for this talk, I was thinking about something in particular. You know, the Bible tells us that Jesus has many names, that Jesus has many titles. He is our Savior, He is our Redeemer, He is our Healer, He is our Rock. He is the fortress that we take refuge in. He is the answer to all of our questions. But the Bible tells us that He's even so much more than that. Because when you open up your Bible, you find out that He is the Alpha and Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He is the Good Shepherd. He is the Great Physician. He is the Light of the World. He is the Bread of Life. And if you keep reading, if you keep going, you'll find out He's the bright morning star. He is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He is the Messiah. He is the author. The Bible says that He is the author and the perfecter of our faith. He is the visible image of the invisible God. He is the great I am. He is the way, the truth, and the life. And nobody comes to the Father except through Him. And Isaiah says that He is the wonderful Counselor. He is the mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. He is Emmanuel. He is the Lamb of God. He is the Son of God. There are many titles attached to Jesus' name. But, I love you guys. Thank you. Here's what got me on my feet when I was getting ready for this. There's one more title that's attached to His name. There is one more title that belongs to Jesus' name. And when I look out on the chaos of this world, when I look out on how crazy things are today and how insane things are today, I wake up every morning and I thank God that there is one more title attached to Jesus' name. He is our King. He is our King. I don't know about you, but He's my King. He is my King. And today I have a special honor. I get to bring a talk that I've always wanted to bring before. In fact, I've never gotten to preach on this subject before, so this is a really fun Sunday for me. But I get to preach about a moment that the Bible prophesies about. I get to preach about a moment where someday our King will come into His kingdom and take charge. You know, right now, because we're in election season, everybody's talking about left versus right, Republicans versus Democrats, red states versus blue states. Look, as my dad always says, when Jesus comes back, He's not coming back to take sides. He's coming back to take charge. That's what He's coming back to do. Because I'm going to read you something from the book of Isaiah. And let me tell you this, no political party can do what I'm going to read for you in a second. No earthly authority can do what I'm about to read for you in a second. In Isaiah chapter 9, it says this. This is what it says about when Jesus reigns and comes into His kingdom. His government and its peace will never end. He will rule with fairness and justice from the throne of His ancestor David for all eternity. And I'm going to be preaching about something that we call the millennial kingdom. It's the 1,000-year reign of Christ. And I'm so pumped to do that. And I'll tell you what, the reason why I'm looking forward to Jesus ruling and reigning is that, I don't know about you, but I look around at this world and I see a world that cannot take good care of itself. Have you noticed this? I mean, I don't care what end of the political spectrum you find yourself on. Can we all agree on like one thing? Can we all agree that we as a human race have made a real mess of things? I think everybody can agree on that. Now there might be somebody in this room who would say, Stephen, you know what? When you talk about Jesus ruling and reigning, I don't know if we need that because you know what? We're making progress. You know, things are not too good, but we're kind of taking one step at a time, you know? We're kind of getting there. But my question is, are we really making progress? You know, I kind of wonder about that. The truth of the matter is, guys, we are not self-reliant. You know, it reminds me of a story. This is one of my favorite stories. This is a very old story. Preachers have been preaching this for years. But there's a story about a guy who worked on a construction site. And he would always brag about how buff he was. You know, he'd always be bragging about how much he could squat and how much he could bench and how much he could curl. You know, and he would drive everybody nuts. You guys know somebody like that? Hey, if you're sitting next to them, don't nudge them, okay? Don't do that. But this guy, he was always bragging about how strong he was. And there was an old man on the construction site that got sick and tired of it. And the old man was like, I need to put this kid in his place, all right? So he came up with a plan. And he went to the young guy and he said, hey, kid, I'll bet you a week's pay that with this wheelbarrow right here, I'll bet you a week's pay that I can wheel something over to that building over there that you can't wheel back. And the young guy was like, well, thanks for the free money, Grandpa. You're on. I'll take that bet. I'll take that bet any day of the week. And the old man was like, all right. And so the old man grabbed the wheelbarrow and he turned to the young guy and he said, all right, kid, get in. That's a goofy story. Here's the thing. When I look out and I see all the craziness of this world, there is one thing that is abundantly clear. You and I, we are not capable of pushing our own wheelbarrows. We are not capable of carrying ourselves. I mean, and the reason for that is you and I, we're broken in a way that no government on earth can fix. I mean, is there any government on this planet that can get us to stop lying? Is there any government on this planet that can get us to keep our word and keep our promises when we should? Is there any government in this world that is able to make us as compassionate as we should be, as merciful as we should be, as loving as we should be? Is there any government in this world that can make us the kind of people that we ought to be? No. Why? Because we are not capable of fixing the brokenness that we see all around us. We're not capable of fixing the brokenness that we see on the news. We need somebody who can do what we can't do. We need somebody who can fix what we can't fix. And there's only one person in the history of the world who has proven that he has the power and the authority to fix humanity's brokenness. And it's because he paid on a cross for humanity's brokenness. And his name is Jesus Christ. And someday he will fix it. And I'm excited to talk about when he reigns for 1,000 years and also when he reigns past that into the new Jerusalem and the new heaven and new earth. And so let me just kind of give you a roadmap of where this series has been and where we are right now. So in week one, if you remember, my dad preached a message called I May Not Need That Old Pine Box. And it was about the fact that there's an event that is coming in the future called the rapture, where God will take his people home. Those of us who are still alive when Jesus comes, the Bible says we'll be caught up in the clouds to meet him. And that's going to be a fantastic event. So we talked about that in week one. In week two, we talked about the tribulation. The Bible tells us there is a 7-year period of time that takes place here on earth after you and I are out of here. And there's a lot of bad things that are going to happen during that season. Plagues, death, destruction. In fact, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 24, he said, if that time were not cut short, no one would survive. But in week three, last week, we talked about the fact that Bible prophecy lines up so much with what has happened throughout history. And my dad gave a wonderful message talking about the book of Daniel. This week, I get to talk about what happens after the tribulation. And I'm very excited to talk about that. If you want to know how the tribulation wraps up, that 7-year period of time, I will tell you exactly how it wraps up. So the Antichrist, the ultimate villain of all villains, he's going to get together everybody who hates God and everybody who hates Israel that's left. And he's going to gather a massive army, the Bible tells us, in the Valley of Megiddo, or maybe you know it by its Greek name, Armageddon. And but the Bible tells us that he will not be successful and he will not defeat God's people. He will not defeat Israel because Jesus is going to come back again and you and I are going to be with him. And he's going to TCOB. He's going to take care of business. And it says this in 2 Thessalonians. It says the Lord Jesus will slay him, the Antichrist. He will slay him with the breath of his mouth and destroy him by the splendor of his coming. And I wouldn't want to be him on that day. Let me tell you this. And if you want to know what happens right after that, check this out. This is Revelation 20, verse 4. And this is what we're going to be talking about today. This is John writing. He said, "Then I saw thrones, and the people sitting on them have been given the authority to judge. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their testimony about Jesus and for proclaiming the word of God." These are people who came to faith during the tribulation who will be martyred for their belief. "They had not worshiped the beast or his statue, nor accepted his mark on their foreheads or their hands. They all came to life again, and they reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. That's where we get the term millennial reign, because it's 1,000. And what's so cool is the people who have been martyred during the tribulation, they will be there because they'll have already, they're going to be raised back. And then those of us who have died before the rapture or were raptured, we will be in our transformed existence and we will be there. We're all going to be there. All of God's family is going to be there. It's going to be awesome. 1,000-year reign of Christ. And so if you notice, the name of this talk is "When Jesus Reigns, dot, dot, dot." I don't usually put an ellipses at the end of titles, but this time I thought, you know what? It builds anticipation. So so it's called "When Jesus Reigns," and I'm really pumped to give that message. And here's what's cool. The Bible has quite a few different names for what the millennial kingdom will look like. In Mark 1:15, it calls it the kingdom of God. In Matthew 5:10, it's called the kingdom of heaven. In Matthew 19:28, I really like this, the renewal of all things. Acts 3:19, the times of refreshing. And my personal favorite, Acts 3:21, the final restoration of all things. There are many names for this kingdom, and I'm excited to talk about that. Today, I promise you, I'm gonna race through these points, but I've got seven things that you and I are gonna see when Jesus reigns. And let me give you number one. When Jesus reigns, there will be peace. There will be peace. You know, did you know our country is 248 years old, and yet according to some scholars, we have only had 15 years total of real peace. And yet in Jesus' kingdom, we will have peace. You know, one thing that doesn't get talked about in church very much is that violence was never a part of God's original design for the world. Did you know that? In the Garden of Eden, there was no assault, there was no murder, there were no nuclear weapons, there were no missiles, there was no need. There was no need for it because there was no sin. There was no violence. It didn't exist. That was God's plan. But when our first parents, Adam and Eve, sinned against God, sin entered the world, and with it, the curse of sin came, and with it came violence. I find it interesting, when you open your Bible, the first example of violence you will find is a man killing his own brother. When Cain killed his brother Abel because he was jealous, God accepted Abel's offering, he rejected Cain's offering, and God told Cain, God actually gave Cain a warning personally. He said, "Cain, you know, sin is crouching at the door waiting to get you. You must subdue it and be its master, Cain. Don't let sin control you." But Cain didn't listen to God, and he killed his own brother in cold blood in a field. And I find it significant that the very first act of violence was someone hurting his own brother. And the reason why I find that significant is according to Acts 17:26, the Bible says that we were all made from one blood, that all of us go back to the same ancestor. And so ever since then, whenever we have senseless killings, ultimately it is a brother killing a brother, or a sister killing a sister, or a brother killing a sister. And it grieves God's heart. God is grieved by violence. Did you know this? In fact, look at what God told Cain. God told Cain this. He said, "What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground." In Psalm 11, verse 5, it takes it to a whole new level, all right? "The Lord examines both the righteous and the wicked. He hates those who love violence." Wow. Now, I will say, there is one caveat to this that we see in Scripture. There are times in the history of the world where God's people have had their backs up against a wall. And because of the curse of sin, God's people have been under attack by evil armies, and God stepped in to help them out and give them the victory. For instance, God's people were oppressed by the Midianites, the Moabites, the Ammonites, the Perizzites, the Termites. No, I'm just kidding. Those last two, no. But they were oppressed by a lot of different ites. And the thing is, when that happened, God wasn't just gonna let them be wiped out. God supernaturally stepped in to help them win the victory time and time again. He also helped them when they were enslaved by Egypt, and God broke their chains and set them free, and God crushed Pharaoh's chariots under the weight of the sea. And so there are times where God has had to help people wage a righteous war, not because it was God's original intention for violence to happen, because it wasn't, but because we live in a sin-cursed world, there is such a thing as good and evil. There is such a thing as righteous and unrighteous, and God has come to the defense of the righteous many times. I think about the history of our nation. America is not a perfect nation, but I think there's been plenty of times where God has supernaturally stepped in to help us when our backs were against the wall, when we were facing the forces of evil. I think about this. I think about when we got attacked on Pearl Harbor in December, that day that will forever live in infamy, according to FDR. When that happened, we didn't choose that fight. We didn't choose that war. War was thrust upon us, and I think God helped us in miraculous and mighty ways. When Hitler invaded Poland and he took over Europe and he put millions of Jews in concentration camps and he murdered millions of innocent people, I believe God supernaturally stepped in and helped us go over there to Europe and tear that short-lived evil empire to shreds and defeat Hitler and destroy him. I think God supernaturally helped us do that, and I'm proud to be the citizen of the country that did that. And in the 1860s, when our country was split apart because of slavery, I know that God supernaturally stepped in to help the Union achieve victory so that our country could be rid forever of the worst sin it ever committed. There are times where God has helped people win a righteous war. And that's why I'm glad we have the best military in the world. I'm glad we have the finest military in the world, and they deserve every last ounce of respect they get and a whole lot more. There's countless men and women who have fought and died so that we could have the right to be sitting here today. And that is very biblical, because you know what John 15 verse 13 says? It says, greater love hath no man than he who lays his life down for his friends. And so the sacrifice of the men and women who have died defending this country, their blood was not in vain. Because there are times where God has helped us win a righteous war. Now, you might say, Stephen, I'm a little bit confused, because earlier you were saying that God hates violence and it was never his original intention. But you've also said that throughout history, there's times where God has intervened to wage a righteous war. Yes. Yes to both. If you want a verse that helps to understand this balance, you need to see Romans 12, verse 18. This is what Paul wrote, and this is the key to understanding. In fact, nations all over the world should pay attention to this verse, because God does not support senseless violence, and he doesn't support wars that have no purpose whatsoever. But this is what Paul wrote. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. And because of this concept, I believe that there is a huge difference between a nation choosing war and war choosing a nation. And that's why I'm glad that God has helped us. But with all that being said, you need to know violence was not God's original plan for the world. It was never God's plan for a human being to hurt another human being. It was never God's plan for someone to kill another person. That wasn't the way it was, but here's what's so cool. Someday when Jesus takes charge, we will finally get to see what peace actually looks like. Every single time, we're not gonna be getting push notifications on our phone every time a drone kills somebody, an innocent life, across the sea. That's not gonna be happening, because there will be peace. There will be peace. Check this out. In Isaiah 9:7, it says, his government and its peace will never end. I don't know about you, but I would like to have peace that never ends. I would like to have that. Isaiah 65, I love this one. The wolf and the lamb will feed together. Now, whenever I see theologians whose theology is really whacked and they try to say that we're already living in the millennium, I have a challenge for them. Try this at the Sedgwick County Zoo. All right? It won't work. This will last for about 2 minutes, and there will be a wolf who will be very well fed, all right? But this will be what it's like when Jesus is in charge. The wolf and the lamb will feed together. The lion will eat hay like a cow. You know what? Someday when we're in the millennium, all of you guys are going to be doing very significant things. And I'm going to be that one guy who's ADD, who's sitting in a field eating some popcorn, watching a lion eat hay like a cow, because to me, that is the most entertaining thing I could ever imagine. I don't know where I was going with that. The lion will eat hay like a cow, but the snakes will eat dust. They have a bad track record, so God's letting us know they're going to eat dust. In those days, no one will be hurt. No one will be hurt or destroyed on my holy mountain. I, the Lord, have spoken. Every time you see in the prophets God saying, I, the Lord, have spoken, what that means is he's saying, I mean business. God is saying no one will be hurt or destroyed on my holy mountain. When I'm in charge, no one's getting hurt. Whew, man, I could use that. Isaiah 2, this is talking about the way Jesus will rule. He will judge between the nations and will settle disputes for many peoples. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. I love that. They're turning instruments of military equipment into farming implements. I like that. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Man, a world without war? That sounds good to me. There will be peace. Number two, and this is the point that'll probably get me in trouble. When Jesus reigns, there will be righteousness. I love this. There will be righteousness. And maybe you say, Stephen, what does righteousness mean? It means what the word implies. Rightness. When Jesus reigns, truth will always win. And evil will not have a foothold. Isn't that that's kind of the opposite of what we see right now, right? I mean, you know, a lie will go all the way around the world before truth is able to get its shirt on, you know? And yet, and when Jesus reigns, things will be right. The righteousness will reign. Isaiah 32 says this, look, a righteous king is coming, and honest princes will rule under him. Then everyone who has eyes will be able to see the truth. Hello, wow. And everyone who has ears will be able to hear it. Even the hotheads will be full of sense and understanding. During an election year, I like that one. Those who stammer will speak out plainly. I have a son who's had to have a lot of surgeries for his speech. So for me, that's a very personal and wonderful verse. In that day, ungodly fools will not be heroes. That's a great refutation of celebrity culture. Scoundrels will not be respected. Justice will rule in the wilderness and righteousness in the fertile field. And this righteousness will bring peace. There will be righteousness. Can you imagine a world where we have a righteous king who never makes a bad decision? Can you imagine a world where everybody who has eyes will be able to see the truth and everybody who has ears will be able to hear it? I mean, can I ask you a personal question? Has there ever been somebody in your life that you love very much, and when you pray for them, you get down on your knees and you pray one thing. You say, God, please open his eyes so that he will see what he is doing. Or say, God, please open her eyes. I love her, but let her see what the choices she's making are so that she can see how to turn to you. Which, by the way, keep praying those prayers, because the Bible tells us that God does not just sweep life away, but he dreams up schemes to bring the rebel home. That's what the Bible says. So if you're praying that today, keep praying. But can you imagine a kingdom where everyone who has eyes will be able to see the truth and everyone who has ears will be able to hear it? That's almost too wonderful to even describe. I don't even know how to put that into words. And maybe there might be somebody skeptical in this room and you would say, Stephen, what do you even mean about God's righteousness? And how do we even know that God can have an impact on society for good or for bad? And how do we know that he's really real? Well, I'm glad you asked. Let me answer it this way. I'm a student of history. I'm a history nerd. I always have been. If there's a 12-step group for recovery, I will go to it. History Anonymous, I don't know. That's a terrible joke. But I love history. I think history can teach us a big lesson about whether God can have an impact on a nation for good or for bad. And I think history can teach us a huge lesson about whether God truly is real or not. For instance, there have been, when you look at history, there have been certain nations where the government of those nations has tried to expel Christianity from public life. For instance, in 1928, Joseph Stalin was in charge of Russia, and he went on a 5-year campaign to try to stamp Christianity out of public life in Russia. And he closed churches down all over the country. He closed Christian schools. He actually got rid of weekends on the Russian calendar so people wouldn't go to church on Sunday. That's a real fact. It's crazy. And he declared that Russia was officially an atheist nation. Now, he wasn't able to stamp out all of Christianity. There's wonderful Christians over in Russia right now. But here's the thing. We have now had about 100 years to look back on the results of what it was like for a society to say, God, we don't want you here. We don't want you in public life. We don't want to listen to you. And we've had 100 years to look back on the results of that. And you know what we see? Let me put it this way. Even if you're an atheist, even if you're somebody who doesn't even believe in God, would you want to move to Russia today? Like, is it a place where people have basic freedoms? Is it a place where you can speak your mind? Is it a place where you can have a free public debate? Is it a place where people can really thrive and reach their full potential? I'll let you answer that question. I know what my answer to that question is, and that's no. You know, and is it a coincidence that in this nation many years ago they said, we want God out of here, we want God out of public life? Is it a coincidence that things got really dark after that? No, it's not a coincidence. And maybe you say, Stephen, you're cherry picking, okay? That's just one example. Hey, I got more, okay? Look, there, throughout history, there's a lot of countries that have systematically tried to expel God from public life. For instance, that list includes North Korea, Somalia, Libya, Yemen, Pakistan, Sudan, Afghanistan, and many others. Now, I'm just curious, has pushing God away benefited any of the nations I just listed? Are any of those places where people have even the most basic rights, are any of those places the kind of place people want to live in? No, in fact, a lot of those countries are places where people want to get out. They want to escape. And by the way, I'm not saying a negative thing about the people who live there. There's wonderful people who live in all of those countries. What I mean is the government there systematically said, God, we don't want you here. We want you out. And then everything became really dark really fast. And that's no coincidence. And yet, here's what's weird. Here in America, I see celebrities and politicians and academics who say, you know what, if we push God away, if we tell him, hey, we don't want you here, it will liberate us. It will enlighten us. It will make us a society where everybody truly feels valued. Oh, the irony. Because when you look back on history, when a nation tries to push God away, it does the opposite of all of those things. Instead of liberating people, it puts them in bondage. Instead of enlightening people, it creates a society where no one has the right to think for themselves. And instead of creating a place where everybody feels welcome and feels valued, it creates a place where everybody feels dominated, manipulated, and controlled. That's what history teaches us. But here's my point, because you might say, Stephen, what point are you getting to, man? Here's my point. Think about it this way. If God wasn't real, a nation would not be benefited by his presence or wounded by his absence. If God wasn't real, I'm just saying, if God didn't exist, no one would be hurt by telling him to go away, and no one would be helped by telling him to come close. For instance, my wife is a real person, just throwing that out there, all right? Last night I said that and she thought that was funny, and I'm glad she thought it was funny because I didn't know how she would react to that. But my wife is a real person and she has a positive impact on me. If I would never do this in a million years, because this would be an awful thing to do and it would be wrong, but if I were to tell her, hey, I don't want you in my life, If I were to tell her, I don't want to spend time with you anymore. I don't ever want to see your face again. I'm done with you. I don't want to have anything to do with you. If I were to push her away, my world would get very dark very fast. And the lights would go out of my world because she is the love of my life. I love her so much. She brings a positive impact to my life. But on the other hand, if I were to do the opposite, which is what I try to do every day, if I were to say, Elle, I want to be closer to you. Elle, I want to get to know you better. I want to spend more time with you. I want us to spend more time together. I want us to study the Bible in the morning. I want us to grow together as a couple. What's going to happen? My world's going to get brighter and brighter and brighter because she is a real woman who has a real positive impact on my life. You know where I'm going with this. Why is it that when nations tell God to come close, things get better? And when nations tell God to step away, that things get worse? Could it be that it's because he's actually real and that his ways are so righteous that when people follow them, they're better off, and when people don't follow them, they get hurt? I think that's the only logical explanation. In fact, I know it is. But let's just put aside the nations for a second. Isn't that true on a personal level? Because I don't know about you, but when in times in my life where I told God I didn't need him, my world got very dark. But when I realized that I have been on the wrong road and I have made some bad decisions and I came around and I got closer to God, things just got better and better and better. And that is the way life works. That is the way life works. If God wasn't real, nobody would be benefited by his presence and nobody would be wounded by his absence. But the fact is, he is very real. He is as real as the back of your hand. He is real. And you know what? The truth is, no nation in history has 100% welcomed God in. I'm proud to be an American. I'm proud of this country. But at no time in our history have we 100% been faithful to what God wanted us to do. And that's why we've never seen what a kingdom of righteousness looks like. And the reason why is Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." So when we try to govern ourselves, sometimes we succeed. Sometimes we fail, but someday we will see a kingdom of righteousness. Someday we will see a kingdom where everyone who has eyes will be able to see the truth and everyone who has ears will be able to hear it. And that will be a righteous and glorious and wonderful kingdom. And I'm looking forward to that. When Jesus reigns, there will be righteousness. I gotta move, man. Number three, when Jesus reigns, there will be healing. I love these verses. These are wonderful verses. Isaiah 35, "Then will the eyes of the blind be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then will the lame leap like a deer and the mute tongue shout for joy." Man, that's powerful, especially as a dad of a son who's dealing with speech surgeries. This is really powerful stuff. And then in Isaiah 65, it says this, God is saying, "I will rejoice over Jerusalem and take delight in my people. Never again will there be in it an infant who lives but a few days, or an old man who does not live out his years." And this is talking about the New Jerusalem. "Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations." You know what? No matter what side of the political spectrum you find yourself on today, our nations need healing. Yes. Our nations need healing. And someday the leaves of the trees in the kingdom of God will be for the healing of the nations. I don't know exactly what that means or what that looks like, but I like it. That's good. Here's the fourth thing. And a lot of people, this is a special one. Not a lot of people know this. When Jesus reigns, there will be continuous day. Zechariah 14, "On that day, there will be neither sunlight nor cold, frosty darkness. It will be a unique day, a day known only to the Lord, with no distinction between day and night. When evening comes, there will be light." That'll be the first time we've ever seen an evening where light comes. That's cool. Number five, when Jesus reigns, there will be justice. Man, we could use some more of that. "His government and its peace will never end. He will rule with fairness and justice from the throne of his ancestor David for all eternity. The passionate commitment of the Lord of Heaven's armies will make this happen. He will not judge by appearance, nor make a decision based on hearsay. He will give justice to the poor and make fair decisions for the exploited." And it's about time. It is about time. Number six, this is my favorite. "When Jesus reigns, there will be joy." There will be joy. This verse is about us. When you see the ransom to the Lord, that's us. These, the ransom to the Lord, will go home along that road to Zion, singing the songs of everlasting joy. For them, all sorrow and all sighing will be gone forever. Only joy and gladness will be there. This is John writing. He said, I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, look, God's home is now among his people. He will live with them and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes and there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are gone forever. When Jesus reigns, New Spring, there will be joy. And you might say, Stephen, why is it that when Jesus reigns, there is joy? The answer to that question is very simple. Jesus has always been the only true source of joy to begin with. You know, a lot of people today chase a lot of things. You know, I know a lot of wonderful people, great people, people I admire, people I love, where they right now they think that a certain career will make them happy, or they think that finding the perfect soulmate will make them happy, or they think if I could just get enough money, or if I could just get enough followers, or if I could just get enough fame, or if I could just get that perfect, you know, get that perfect house. And you know what? There's nothing wrong with any of those things. I'm not knocking any of it, but I am saying this. You will not find true joy in that, because only a relationship with Jesus Christ is the place to find true joy. Only in him can you find out what true joy really looks like. And I just want to ask a personal question. I mean, have you ever been chasing after all those things and you realized it was never enough? I know I have. I mean, it really is kind of like chasing the carrot on the stick, because you work hard, you get the money, you get the house, you work hard, you work and work and work, but the happiness that you thought you could get from things, you realize you couldn't get because it was never enough. Maybe you'd say, Stephen, that's how I feel right now. It kind of reminds me of a story. I'm a huge fan of Michael Jordan. I love MJ. He's the greatest athlete of all time, hands down. Like Tom Brady's okay, Michael Jordan is awesome. That's just how I feel, okay? One of my favorite MJ stories is from the 1996 NBA Finals. And Michael was leading the Bulls to victory over the Sonics. But what's interesting is the number one thing people remember from that game didn't happen on the court. The number one thing that people remember from that game happened after the game. Because after the game was over, Michael had just won the big one. He had just won the game of all games. And yet, when a lot of other people were jumping up and down and celebrating and high-fiving and chest bumping and all that stuff, Michael was on the floor of the locker room. And he had a basketball right in front of his face. And he was crying and tears just kept streaming down his face. And nobody could stop him from crying. Nobody could stop him from weeping. Why? It was Father's Day. And if you know the story, a few years before that, Michael had lost his dad in a tragic murder, in a tragic murder. And why was Michael crying? Why were the tears coming down? Because no victory was ever going to truly feel like a victory if he couldn't enjoy it with his father. Today, if you're chasing after all the things this world has to offer and you wonder why there's still a hole in your heart and you wonder, why do I still feel empty? Why do I still feel like something's missing? Can I just tell you in love, it's because no victory will ever truly feel like a victory until you can enjoy it with your Heavenly Father. And he wants to do that for you. That if you're looking for joy today, which I think all of us are, if you're looking for joy today, there is one place you can find it. You can find it in Jesus Christ. That is where you can find it. And that is why when Jesus reigns, there will be joy. Here's my last point. Number 7, when Jesus reigns, there will be room. I get such a privilege to stand up here and tell you that there's room in the kingdom. The number one thing, if you only remember one thing I say from this entire message, please remember this. There is room in the kingdom for you. And maybe you'd say, Stephen, you don't know what I've done. You're right. I don't know what you've done, but God knows what you've done. And he says, there's room for you. He says, there's room. Maybe you'd say, Stephen, I've got a past. Hey, we've all got a past. And guess what? Even if you've got a past, guess what? You also have a future. And there's room for you. There's room for you. John chapter 14. Jesus said, my Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. There are many rooms in the Father's house. There's not just a few. There's not just a handful. There are many, and there's a room for you. There is a seat at the family table for you. And maybe you'd say, Stephen, how is that possible? It's possible because of this. It's possible because Jesus died to make that room. You know, maybe you'd say, Stephen, I don't know, how could there be room for me? Because I've been shaking my fist at God. I've told God, I don't want you in my life. You talked about pushing God away. Maybe you'd say, Stephen, I have been pushing him away. I've been rebelling against him. I've been telling him, I don't want you. I don't want your influence in my life. I don't want to have anything to do with you. Maybe you'd say, Stephen, I've been shaking my fist at God. I have good news for you. Even if you've been shaking your fist at God, he has not been shaking his fist at you. Instead of a fist, you know what God is doing with his hand today? His hand isn't in a fist. His hand is open. And it's open to you. And if you wonder, how could there be room for me? There's room for you because, you know, the open hand of Jesus that I'm talking about, 2,000 years ago, he opened up both of his hands. And they drove nails through them. The Bible says that he was whipped. There would be bits of bone and glass in the whip, so it would cause the flesh to come right off somebody's back. He was beaten and he was whipped and he was abused. Why? So that there could be room in the kingdom for you. They put a crown of thorns on his head. And they put a purple robe on him to try to make fun of him. And they spit on him and they made fun of him. They did terrible things. And that crown of thorns was on his head. Why? So that there could be room in the kingdom for you and me. And he carried a cross down the road. There was a wonderful man from Cyrene who helped him carry it. But you see, if you've seen paintings of him carrying that cross, why is he carrying that cross? So that there could be room in the kingdom for you. And then he went to Golgotha. He went to the place of the skull, and there they nailed the nails in his hands and feet. And he hung there gasping for breath for hours. And he said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And he died so that there could be room in the kingdom for you. And 3 days later, he walked out of the grave conquering death and hell so that there could be room in the kingdom for you. I have the honor of telling you that if you've never invited him in, there's room for you. No matter what, it doesn't matter what you've done, it doesn't matter how you failed, there's room. The question is, are you gonna claim that space? Today, I've been talking about the fact that someday Jesus will rule and reign, but the number one question that you need to ask yourself today is he the king of my heart? I was listening to music, getting ready for this message, and you know, I'm ADD, so I have a lot of different kinds of music on my Spotify playlist, so I get just about everything, you know. But I heard this song, and I started crying, and I don't cry very easily, okay? But the tears just kept coming down my face because I was working on the ending of this message, and the song was called The King of My Heart. And in just a moment, I'm going to come out here, and I'm going to give an invitation. But before I do, I want you to hear this song because this song preaches this message better than I could ever preach it. And while you hear this song, if you've never invited him in, I just want you to think about this because he wants to be the king of your heart. I'm gonna be back out in just a second, but I want you to hear this song. Thank you. Spring, before we wrap things up, I just have one more question for you. Is he the king of your heart? And if he isn't, today is the day to invite him in, because he loves you and because there is room in the kingdom for you, and he has made room for you, and it doesn't matter what you've done, there is a place with your name on it. And I will you all just bow your heads and pray with me really quick? And if he's already the king of your heart, then pray for anyone in this room who hasn't made that decision yet, because I believe the Holy Spirit is moving in this room in mighty ways. And so if anybody said, this is what you need to know. Jesus loves you so much. He loves you so much that he laid his life down, and he wants to be the king of your heart. He wants to change your life. And you know what? It is a gift. Because a lot of people might say, well, what about religion? Religion is is a man-made way of trying to reach out to God that's not even real, because religion is all about jumping through hoops and following a certain set of things. You know what? A relationship with Jesus is all about just calling out to him, saying, yes, I want you in my heart. Yes, I want you in my life. And if you want to do that, it's easy. Romans 10, 9 through 10 says, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. It doesn't say you might be saved. It doesn't say you could be saved. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved, and you can be saved today. You can be saved today. And don't wait for tomorrow, because we're not guaranteed tomorrow. And don't wait for next week, because we're not guaranteed next week. Today is the day of decision. Today, when he's close, don't harden your hearts, but invite him in. If that's what you want to do, if you've never made him the king of your heart, if you've never invited him in, let's do that right now. Right now. I'm going to pray a prayer. And these aren't magic words, but these are words just calling out to God, saying, yes, I want you in my heart. If you want to make that decision, if you want to do that, you can pray this with me. You could pray it out loud, or you could pray it silently in your heart. Either way, all that matters is that you're calling out to Jesus, saying you want him. If you want him today, then pray with me. Heavenly Father, I know I've done wrong things. I know I've sinned, but I believe you love me. I believe you sent your son to die for me. And I believe he rose from the grave. Please come into my heart. Forgive me and save me. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, before you go, sorry I'm in overtime, but before you go, if you just made that decision, we have something that we want to give you, and this is a completely free gift. It doesn't cost anything at all, but it's a box. And inside of this box, it has a brand new NewSpring Bible. And it also has a book called My New Walk with God. My dad wrote this book when he was going through the toughest time of his life. And if you just accepted Christ and you have questions, which I'm sure you do, this book answers a lot of those questions, but also it's just a powerful book talking about what we know about Christ. And also there's a journal in here and some other really cool things. If you want this box, all you have to do is text the word PRAYED, P-R-A-Y-E-D, to 97,000. Or if you're watching online, or if you're watching on television, just text the word PRAYED to 97,000. You can do it too. Or if you want to get this box today, if you're like, get it in my hands now, if you want to do that, all you have to do is just go out to guest services out front here. They won't hassle you or stalk you or anything. They just want to give this to you for free, just to celebrate the decision that you made. And also, there's a guest services over by the wire, and you can go there, and we will get this box in your hands, because if you've accepted Christ, we want to get a Bible to you. We want to get this book to you, because we care about you, and we want to just help you on your new journey with God. Thank you so much for letting me go so far in overtime. Love you guys. Have a great rest of your Sunday. Sunday.